Today, as we continue our series, Reality Check, we're going to take a look at King Hoshea. Now, you may not know much about King Hoshea, but there's not a whole lot to know. In fact, today, we're not going to talk a whole lot about Hoshea. In fact, we're going to talk a lot more just about the nation of Israel itself. But I will tell you the little bit that we know about Hoshea, about what happened. When he was king, he was king in Israel. Remember, we talked about the divided kingdom, how there's 10 tribes in the north, that's called Israel, and there's 2 tribes in the south, that's known as Judah. And ever since King Solomon, those kingdoms have been divided. So Hoshea is king in the north, king of Israel. And at this time, Israel is not very powerful. See, because the Assyrians, they were the real power at the time. They had come and they had attacked Israel. And as a result, Israel became Assyria's vassal. And so every year they had to pay tribute to Assyria for protection or kind of for an alliance. But it's kind of like their nation was a servant of the Assyrians. So Israel's not all that powerful. But when Hoshea gets to become king, he's like, well, I don't want to pay tribute every year. How about this? I'll stop paying tribute and I'll go to the king in Egypt. I want to make an alliance with him, and maybe he can protect us against the Assyrians. The king of Assyria finds out about this, and he's like, nope, that's not how we do things around here. And so he comes to Israel. He puts the city, the capital city of Samaria, to siege for 3 years, and eventually at the end of that, carries off all the people off to Assyria. And that's the end. That's the end of the people of Israel. Of the 10 northern tribes, that's it. That's the last king that these 10 northern tribes will have, Hoshea. And in fact, this is not like what happens with the kingdom of Judah. I don't know if you remember, but the kingdom of Judah gets, at one point in its history, gets taken off into exile up in Babylon. But then, right, eventually they get to come back and rebuild the temple and rebuild the walls. And that's why, like, when Jesus is around, that there's still Jewish people there in Judah. That does not happen for the kingdom of Israel. They're just gone. They get assimilated into the nation of Assyria, and Assyria just places new people from other nations in that area. And so those 10 tribes are basically never heard from again. How could this happen? Weren't these supposed to be God's special people? His chosen nation? His people that he brought out of Egypt, that he protected and cared for, and now they're gone. Well, not gone, but forgotten. Unidentifiable from any other nation. How did this happen? Well, actually, that's what the rest of the chapter tells us about. How did we get from this nation of Israel being God's special possession to being cut off and forgotten? We're going to read here from 2 Kings chapter 17, starting at verse 6. I'll read verse 6 before we... In the 9th year of Hoshea, the king of Assyria captured Samaria and deported the Israelites to Assyria. He settled them in Halah, in Gozan, near the Habor River, and in the towns of the Medes. All this took place because the Israelites had sinned against the Lord their God, who had brought them up out of Egypt from under the power of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. They worshipped other gods and followed the practices of the nations the Lord had driven out before them, as well as the practices that the kings of Israel had introduced. The Israelites secretly did things against the Lord their God that were not right. From watchtower to fortified city, they built themselves high places in all their towns. They set up sacred stones and Asherah poles on every high hill and under every spreading tree. Just a note on this. These high places, spreading trees, these were the typical pagan worship locations. When there was a hill, like, that's a place of worship. A big tree with lots of shade, that's a place where people would worship. And so instead of worshiping where God told them to worship, anytime you hear about the high places, that's idolatry. It's not worship of the true God, but it's idolatry. So we keep reading at verse 11. At every high place, they burned incense, as the nations whom the Lord had driven out before them had done. They did wicked things that aroused the Lord's anger. They worshipped idols, though the Lord had said, "You shall not do this." The Lord warned Israel and Judah through all his prophets and seers, "Turn from your evil ways. Observe my commands and decrees in accordance with the entire law that I commanded your ancestors to obey and that I delivered to you through my servants, the prophets." But they would not listen and were as stiff-necked as their ancestors, who did not trust in the Lord their God. They rejected his decrees and covenants he had made with their ancestors, and the statutes he had warned them to keep. They followed worthless idols, and themselves became worthless. They imitated the nations around them, although the Lord had ordered them, "Do not do as they do." They forsook all the commands of the Lord their God, and made for themselves two idols cast in the shape of calves and an Asherah pole. They bowed down to all the starry hosts and they worshiped Baal. They sacrificed their sons and daughters in the fire. They practiced divination and sought omens and sold themselves to do evil in the eyes of the Lord, arousing his anger. This is God's word. So that's kind of a history of how Israel got to where it is. How they went from being God's special people to being gone. So how would you summarize it? They left God. And they followed other idols. They left the true, eternal, all-powerful God for the idols that were popular around them. Here's how he puts it in verse 14. But they would not listen and were as stiff-necked as their ancestors, who did not trust in the Lord their God. You see, it wasn't just that they did one really bad thing and then all of a sudden God cut them off. But it was the fact that they sinned, they followed other idols, and God continually sent prophets to warn them again and again and again, saying, don't do this. Turn around. This is so bad for you. But they didn't listen. In fact, it says they were stiff-necked, which means, like, stiff-necked means being stubborn. That's it literally says in Hebrew, like, they were difficult or stiff of neck. And what does that mean? It means to be stubborn, right? It means to say, if someone tells you to turn your head, you say, no, 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 I'm not turning my head. I'm not doing what you're saying because I think I know what's best. You know the interesting thing about being stubborn? No one thinks that they're stubborn. They just think that they're right. Or if anyone thinks that they're stubborn, they think that it's a good quality, because they're sticking to what is really good, you know. And there's a place, right? There's a place for being steadfast and saying, I'm going to stick with the Lord and not be pushed around. But that's not what it's talking about here. When he says that they were stiff-necked, it means that when God said, no, turn away, stop doing this, they wouldn't do it. And it's important just for us to remember, like, why are people stubborn? It's because they think they're right. It's because they think they know better. So whenever God's prophets would tell them to turn from their evil ways, to turn away from idolatry, listen to God, it wasn't just because they were, like, not smart or something. It's because they thought they knew better. They thought that whatever God was saying, that doesn't apply to me. Or really what I think, or the thing that I'm doing, it has a good reason behind it, so I'm not going to listen to that. And so they were stiff-necked. So when God sent them prophets and warned them, they wouldn't listen. Right? It's like it says in verse 13 here, the Lord warned Israel and Judah through all his prophets and seers, turn from your evil ways. Observe my commands and decrees. And that word turn is going to be important. We're going to come back to that in a second. That's something that God often talks about when he talks about repenting. It's like a turning, right? Turning back to God and turning away from your sin. So, reality check. It's our first chance for a reality check to look in the mirror here for a second. How do we see ourselves in the people of Israel? Well, it's not that, you know, you guys have just totally rejected God and have left him and all those things. You know, sometimes you come across things like this, and sometimes people say, well, we're just like the people of Israel. Well, not exactly, right? Because you are here wanting to listen to God, wanting to worship him. But yet there is something we could learn. God didn't want them to be stiff-necked. He wanted them to listen to him. And when he said turn, when he gave them advice, when he said go this way and not that way, he wanted them to listen and to do what he said. So Christians, are you stiff-necked toward God? I'm sure we'd like to say no, of course. When God says something, like, I know that he means well for me, I know that he loves me, and so when he tells me to do something, I'm going to do it. But I think you know that while that might be true for some areas of your life, there are some parts of your life that are password protected from God. Some parts of your life that you say, okay, well, God, you can tell me how to do this and how to do that. And yep, what you said right there, that sounds good. Love one another. Okay, I got that. But, you know, maybe there's certain parts of my life where I say that's just, that one's for me, right? that part of my life, I'm just going to do that for me, right? I'll give like some offerings to God, but the rest of my money, that I can spend however I want because that's mine. I've done my thing for God. But now the rest of my money, now that's, right, that's mine, and that's how I get to decide how I spend my stuff. Or to put it another way, maybe there are certain doors in our life that are closed to God. And we hear what God says, but we won't let that influence the actual way that we live in that part of our life. And so in that way, we could say we're stiff-necked. Because we think, well, no, I mean, if I were to really apply that to this part of my life, right, it would all fall apart. But my way of doing things, I think that this is better, right? If I were really to just see the money that I have, for example, as God's money, man, it would all fall apart. Like I wouldn't have enough left. I have to manage this the way I would do it, not the way that God would tell me to do it. All right. And in that way, that's being stiff-necked, right? That's being stubborn. And let's call it what it is. That's sin. And the way that God often talked about sin in the Old Testament is a turning away from God. And let's be really honest about sin. Sin is not just a small little mistake. It's not just a little accident. It's turning away from God. It's saying, God, I see your path. I like this one. And I'm going to go this way instead. Sin is turning away from God. And so what does God encourage us to do in his word? It's to turn back to him. Right? Here's how he says it in Ezekiel chapter 33. He says this, "Say to them, as surely as I live, declares the sovereign Lord, I take no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but rather that they turn from their ways and live. Turn from your evil ways. Why will you die, people of Israel?" You hear the pleading heart of your God? He says, turn from your evil ways. You think you know where you're going, but it's bad. You're going to die. You're going to perish. This is going to be terrible for you. Turn. That word, turn, in Hebrew is the word that's also used for repent. So when he's telling these people, turn, it's not just like turn from bad stuff and just turn to good stuff. It's not just like turn away from the evil and do just anything else. Or just turn from the evil and just do good stuff, even though that's part of it. Ultimately, when God tells us to turn from our sin, it's not just turn away from the bad and turn to doing good. It's turn away from the bad and turn to God. Perhaps this verse from Joel will help us just to see that. So in Joel chapter 2, he puts it this way. "Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love. He relents from sending calamity." And I love that passage because it talks about repentance not as something that we do just because we feel bad and now we want to just do the right thing, or that we feel like we've done too many bad things and now we need to do good things. No, repentance is turning to God because God is gracious and compassionate. When we see our sin, we turn to God knowing what we will receive when we turn to him. Forgiveness, compassion, love that does not fail. So we don't turn to God primarily because we just want to do some nice stuff. We turn to God because he is love, because he is good. So when God was encouraging his people to turn around, it wasn't just like, you did bad things, now do good things. He's saying, come back to me. You're going your own way. You're trying to live without me. I want you to turn back to me. Come back to me. And the problem that the people had is that they had turned away to what they thought was going to add value and add worth to their lives. That they thought they knew what was right. They thought they knew what they were doing. But it turns out it was going to be their destruction. Here's how it's put in verse 15 of our reading. It says, "They rejected his decrees and the covenant he had made with their ancestors, and the statutes he had warned them to keep. They followed worthless idols, and themselves became worthless." Man, that's an interesting phrase, isn't it? They followed worthless idols, and themselves became worthless. I want us to think about that a little bit today. We're kind of going to close our sermon with just this idea. The idea behind it is simple, right? They followed worthless idols, and themselves became worthless. The idea that the idols that they followed, they weren't worth anything. They had worshipped the true God who was had almighty power and full wisdom and knew all things, and they deserted that God for other gods that really just weren't real. They were made up. They couldn't protect them. They couldn't help them. They couldn't save them. They couldn't do a thing for them. They were worthless. They added no worth to their lives. They could not help them in any single way. And I know it's really, really easy for us to look at them and say, like, how could you not see this, right? It's easy for us to look at those people and say, like, you had God who brought you out of Egypt. You had his prophets talking to you. Like, the true God is so obviously more powerful and worthwhile than these other gods. Why in the world would you follow after these worthless idols? And it's really easy for us to stand kind of outside of the story objectively and say, that's so dumb, right? Like, why would you follow these worthless idols? What if we could have that perspective on our own lives? Like, we're able to look at them and say, like, wow, yeah, that was so worthless and such a waste of time and didn't help them. But what if we could stand apart from our own lives and have that same perspective? Like, imagine in 100 years if someone's able to look back on your life, what would they say is worthless? What would they say? Oh, my goodness. Oh, I can't believe that he is chasing after that. I can't believe she's wasting time on that. That's so worthless in the grand scheme of things. Right? Because these people, I mean, they weren't like unintelligent. They were rational people. They followed these idols because they thought, I don't know exactly why, but they thought for some reason that it was worth their time. I mean, that is kind of what worship is. Worship is something you think is worth your time, worth your energy. They thought it was worth it for some reason. So, you know, was it the fact that kind of everybody around them was doing it and they didn't want to be the odd one out? Was it the fact that maybe they just felt inside, they didn't feel the presence of God and they didn't feel like he was doing anything in their life, but they saw other people sacrificing to Baal and to Asherah, and it seemed like their crops were flourishing, and they thought, well, you know, might as well cover my bases. Maybe I was wrong about this. Or, I mean, you heard in our reading how he talked about, like, these are the practices of other nations, the people around you. You keep going after them. Even I told you not to do this. And, like, you got to imagine that peer pressure had to be a part of it. This is what everyone else is doing. And they weren't doing this unreasonably. They thought this was the right thing to do. They thought that this was a way that would bring good things to their life. And so it happens that when people are following worthless idols, sometimes they don't see their worthlessness. So what if we could stand outside of our lives and see the worthlessness of our idols? What would someone say like 100 years from now, right? If they could look at your life objectively, what would they say? Stop scrolling, right? There's the next thing is not going to give you the happiness that you think it will. You keep on looking for something that will give you joy, but it won't. It won't give you the pleasure, the joy, the fulfillment that you're looking for. What if we could see the worthlessness of our own idols? Would you say to yourself, why does he care so much about what other people think about him? Doesn't he know that he'll never be satisfied by that? That another person who adores him or thinks highly of him won't ultimately fill him up the way that he wants it to? And in fact, if he had 1,000 people that loved and respected him, the one person that doesn't, that'd be the thing that he thinks about? Why is he spending time on this worthless pursuit, this worthless idol? What if we could see the worthlessness of the idols that we follow? We'd say, oh my goodness, I know that you just, you know, you want that upgrade or that next thing. You think that if you just have a little bit more money, you'd be able to provide a little bit more security for your life, right? Or if you finally get that upgrade on your phone or get to that new house or get that new couch or get that new TV or whatever it is that, finally, then things will be a little bit more at peace. But the reality is, man, that's not going to do it for you. So stop putting your hope in those things. What if we could see the worthlessness of our own idols? What if you could look at your own life and just see how worthless all those pursuits that aren't God and they aren't the things that God tells us to pursue? Perhaps we'd find ourselves looking in the mirror and saying, wow, yeah, I've kind of fallen into the same trap that they did. And I look down on them for the worthlessness of their idols, but man, the idols that I have are just as much a waste of time. Now, I want us to think, though, about the second half of this passage, because I think this is really interesting. They followed worthless idols and themselves became worthless. Now, you could see this as just kind of like a mirror image of the first part of the phrase, right? They followed worthless idols and, like, it wasn't worth it to them, or it was a waste of time, right? But that's not exactly what it says. They followed worthless idols and themselves became worthless. It's talking about, like, it changed who they were. Simply put, what it's saying is they cut themselves off from the thing that gave their lives worth. The thing that made their lives worthwhile, the thing that made their lives worth anything was God and knowing Him. And so when they cut themselves off from God, they didn't just cut themselves off from like good things that come from God. They cut themselves off from the thing that gave their life worth. They cut themselves off from the thing that gave their lives worth, and so they became worthless. So friends, what is it that you think gives your life value? What is it that you think gives your life worth? Like, what if at every funeral, there was one guy whose job it was to, without any compassion whatsoever, say, "Who cares?" Right? What if somebody had to stand up and say, like, who cares that he lived or died? Like, who cares that she lived on this earth? Somebody, prove it to me. Stand up and tell us. What if someone had to do that at every funeral? I'm sure we all hope that people would have something to say that would answer that question. And I think even though that doesn't happen, I think sometimes we live our lives just hoping that at the end, people will be able to answer that question. We live our lives thinking like, okay, what can I do in my life that will add value, that will make people think that my life was worth living? But if you're answering that question apart from God, you won't find a satisfactory answer. In fact, imagine a world without God. Right? If we say that life has worth because of our connection to God, imagine a world without God, where there's no divine plan, there's no divine design. We are just a collection of molecules reacting to the stimuli around us. And you know what? In 100,000 years or whatever, you know, maybe this world won't exist, or the universe will, you know, big massive explosion or something like that, and it'll all be gone. And so, like, the murderer and the philanthropist and the doctor and the teacher, and it doesn't matter how they lived at all because there was no divine plan. They're just gone. Like, see, when you take God out of the picture, life loses its worth. Because all you have is right here. But what gives life value is God. Not only because it means that there is more to come after this span of years that we have, but He is the one that gives your life value. Not the things that you've accomplished, not the entertainment and the pleasure and the things that you've taken in, all the experiences, all the stuff that you have. That's not what gives your life worth. The Bible is really clear about this. What gives you your worth is God. Let me give you a couple of passages just to think about that. First, here in 2 Corinthians says this: "You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies." What's your price? What's your value? What are you worth? It's not your accomplishments. It's not the things that you've amassed in your life. What gives you your worth is that you are worth the death of God's Son. You are worth Jesus dying for you. Right, so if at your funeral somebody were to stand up and says, "Who cares?" Someone could stand up and say, "You know why she matters? Because God chose her. Because God died for her. He sent His Son to sacrifice for her. So she is absolutely worth it. You know why she's worth it? Because she's a daughter of the King. God calls her His own, and so yes, her life was worth it. Yes, His life was worth it." Or perhaps these words too from 1 Peter: "For you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver or gold, that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect." See, it's not just important to listen to the word of God for what's right and what's wrong, but to listen to the word of God to know why we're valuable, to know why we matter, to know why our lives are worth living, and that there's 1,000 voices out there that will tell you whether you're worth something or not, based on how you look, based on how much you benefit society, based on what you've accomplished, and those things do not determine your worth, Christians. They don't. And perhaps the best way I've seen it put, besides what's in the scriptures, comes from a kid's book. It's called the Jesus Storybook Bible. And this is how the author puts it. This is the story of creation. When God creates Adam and Eve, it says this: they were lovely because he loved them. That's who you are. In God's eyes, you're lovely. Not because you've succeeded in this area or that area, you've been this good or this bad. You're lovely because God loves you. And that's what gives your life worth. Not when what someone else says about you. You're lovely because God loves you. Your life is worth something because it took the precious blood of Jesus to pay for it, to redeem you. So your worth is not in what you own. Your worth is not in what you've accomplished. Your worth is not the sum of your good and bad decisions. Your worth is found in knowing God and knowing that he knows you completely. And if God says that your life is worth it, that's all we really need to hear, isn't it? That's all we need to hear, right? God says my life is worth it, then it is. So let's follow him. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, help us to listen to you. Help us to see the wisdom in your words, in your encouragements, to turn away from sin and to turn to you. Also help us to see in your word our value, our worth. God, thank you for giving our lives worth. Help us to believe that. Help us to live that. In Jesus' name, amen.